Hi and welcome to Curator with a Camera. I'm Anthony Coulls, Senior Curator of Rail Transport and Technology, and today we're going to have a look inside the very first 125 power car. We're here in the Great Hall of the National Railway Museum to have a really good look at the 125 power car, Sir Kenneth Grange. It's the first production power car. That means this was the very first one that entered service in the 1970s. It is an absolute icon of engineering and design. But what is it that makes the 125 special? Let's go and have a look. The 125 is born out of wanting to go faster on a creaking network, on an existing railway that has only just got rid of steam locomotives. The last steam engine runs on the main line in everyday service in August 1968. Less than a decade later, the 125 is there. And it's called the 125 because it's designed to run continuously at 125 miles an hour on the fastest parts of the national network. British Rail engaged a design consultant company employing Kenneth Grange. Now, Kenneth Grange is a name that we're going to hear again and again throughout our time looking at this loco. And Kenneth Grange was an industrial designer, and his company were engaged to look at how this train was going to look, the livery of it. Kenneth Grange couldn't resist thinking, well, how am I actually going to help make this thing go faster rather than just the look of it? And he came up with this wedge-shaped front end, which was so different to what had been before. Now, you'll notice here that something that is very different and missing from the front end of the 125 are the buffers and the couplings and the draw gear that you see on a conventional locomotive. BR said to Kenneth Grange, these 125s will operate in fixed sets of power cars and carriages. Therefore, they do not need these traditional buffers and draw gear. And that gave Kenneth Grange the green light that he needed to give the 125 this stunning look, the look that is unencumbered by messy buffers and couplings, which I think you'd say would actually spoil the lines of it if it had buffers fitted. These are parts that you'll never see with a 125 coupled to its carriages. You've got what's called a buckeye coupling in the middle there, and then the air brake pipes. It's a mobile powerhouse, and it's got a compressor here. That there would have been operated by the electricity from the loco to make air to operate the brakes on the machine itself. It carries its own batteries underneath it so you can start it. It has a fuel tank as well. And you can see there, it's nice and empty now, but there's a fair amount of fuel oil goes into that tank there. And once again, that incredible vision of that wonderful front end, that chiseled driving forward image that was so redolent of the 1970s BR publicity. This is the age of the train. This was the train of the future. This is the train that nobody actually realised it would manage to run for over 40 years and is still running on certain parts of the network today. But what's it like inside this thing? Let's go and have a look. Now we're in the cab of the locomotive, and we'll have a little bit of a look around and see what's what. In essence, it's as it is when it was switched off for the last time in the summer of 2019 and brought into the museum. We've got all the marks of a working life on the locomotive, and we've got some of the notices from when it was last in use. The cab itself is made out of fiberglass. It's very light. It allows you to have that shape that it has. It's air conditioned. You think about all this glass around us. You know, it's going to be like in a greenhouse in many ways. You can imagine how warm this would get. So this is a view that 99% of our visitors will never get. It's quite ironic, really, that we're looking out at some of the steam exhibits in the museum. And the green engine here is a Stevenson long boiler locomotive from 1875, exactly 100 years before the 125, before Sir Kenneth Grange was created and hit the rails. And there's a whole century of locomotive development between the steam engine and this diesel electric high speed train power car. You know, the steam engine there, it's full of soot, it's full of oil, it's cold, it's black, it gets you filthy. And here we're in an air conditioned cab, we've got a windscreen, we've got heaters, and we've even got very comfy seats. Hello, Lee, give us a wave. Excellent. Well, I always say that with a railway engine, it's the easiest thing in the world to make it go. How do you make it stop? Well, quite simply, we've got a very large brake handle here. And of course, you can't just put the brakes on because otherwise, you know, the wheels would skid and you have all sorts of issues. And the passengers, of course, have a very, very bumpy ride. But you've got a very gradual brake there that can be applied smoothly and steadily to allow the train to decelerate. If that's the stop handle, how do you make it actually go? Very, very simple. Like the brake handle, there is a power handle here. There's a master key here, which says off, which means it's turned off, engine only, and then rev and four for reverse and forward. That sets the direction. This is the power handle here. It has five notches from 0 to 5, and you take that through that. And that's as simple as it is. We do have a fail safe though, of course, in front of us, and it's called the DSD, otherwise known as the dead man's pedal. And you have to keep your foot pressed on that at all times as the train's going along. If you take your foot off the pedal, then within a very short time, few seconds, the brakes will come on and the train will come to a complete stand. We have the speedometer right in front of us. The driver knows exactly how fast he's going. We have an ammeter there so that the driver can see how much power is being put through to the electric motors driving the wheels. That's really important. You don't want to overload it. You don't want to fry your motors. That's very, very expensive. We have various pressure gauges for the brakes as well, the main brake air pipe, and then reservoir and train pipes across the way, so the driver knows exactly how much braking is being applied and how much air he has still in the system to use afterwards. It's really quite a complicated thing, this 125. The bit that every child loves on a train is the horn, and we have four tones here. You've got high and low, which give the train that distinctive dee-dah that you hear, but you've got loud and soft. So if you're in a residential area or somewhere that you don't necessarily need to be quite so loud, but you still need the train to be heard, you can be a little more, how should we put it, respectful of those that you're surrounding with. We've got this large windscreen. This is because when the prototype was being trialled out, Kenneth Grange designed it so that it had one seat for the driver in the centre of the cab. And of course, the unions didn't like that. They were used to trains having a fireman or a second man within the cab to of equal import as the driver. So the unions blacked the 125 prototype. They would not operate it. They said, we're not going to drive it. We're not going to test it. You've got to sort this out. And that became the sticking point with the train, but it also became the pivot by which the 125 gained its shape, because in insisting that the 125 had space for both the second man, whose seat that was there, and the driver, the seat this is here, the windscreen had to be made so much wider. Now, new glass technology meant that they were able to do that, but the shape of the loco had to change, because with a wider window at the front, different glass, you had to change the aerodynamics of it as well. So we've had a look in the front end of the loco, but what makes the 125 tick? Well, we'll take a walk through the power car now. It's a little bit dark, we might not get to see everything, but we'll take a walk through and see where we go. Walking through the power car is a bit like some people have described it as walking through a submarine. It's quite narrow, it's quite confined in spaces, it's quite tight. You really wouldn't want to be doing this when the engine is in full operation. It's a diesel electric locomotive, so the diesel power unit itself is creating electricity. So you've got a diesel engine in here and a generator to create the electricity. The 125s had a lot of rebuilds during their life, a lot of maintenance. So what we've got in here isn't original to 1975. This is as it came out of service in 2019. So the 125 power cars were made initially with Paxman of Colchester Valenta diesel engines. They came out of service, they were re-engined when they realised that the 125 had further life ahead of it. The Valentas were all replaced in the late 90s, early 2000s with MTU diesel power units. And that's what we have through here. As I mind my head, like I say, the clearances are quite limited, but here you go, the MTU power unit itself. Full working order and exactly as it was switched off in June 2019. It's like a bit of a time capsule, and this is history forever. And one emerges into the guards and luggage compartment as was. This was initially built as the guards compartment and the luggage compartment. The guards on a train is very important. They look after the safety of the passengers. They look after the safety of what you're carrying. What BR hadn't bargained for was, of course, through that door there is a 2,250 horsepower diesel engine screaming at full chat at 125 miles an hour. This is not a good working environment to put your guard in. So it's not long before the guard is relocated into the next carriage. This remains as a luggage compartment for you to be able to carry parcels, bicycles, whatnot. We talked earlier about the 125 getting its iconic look by not having buffers and draw gear and no couplings on. So how do you move a 125 if it's crippled, if it can't move itself? Simple, you have an emergency coupling. The front end lifts up, there's a hatch, and this coupling bar attaches to the front of the engine. You can bring a traditional vehicle that has draw gear and buffers to it, and you can pull it clear and away to a place of safety or a place of repair. So that's the interior of the 125 power car. It's changed a lot throughout its life. It's been re-equipped, it's had re-engineered, it's had the new power unit put in, but the fabric of the train is still the same. This is still the 125 as it came into service in the 1970s. This is Sir Kenneth Grange as originally built. Thanks for joining us for Curator with a Camera. We hope you've enjoyed it, and if you have, please leave a like, and why not subscribe to our YouTube channel.